Yeah, contractors are screaming out for technology to be enabled. I mean, we're well and truly into, you know, modern technology and cloud-based, and everyone's got a smartphone and all of those things. So I think, you know, whoever, you know, the products that are out there that have a clean, simple interface, easy to use, and really solve a meaningful business problem are having a lot of success right now.
Hey everybody, it's Reed
and Kurt,
and you're listening to Builtcast, brought to you by Bangert Inc.
Today on Builtcast, we are excited to announce Bangert's partnership with Assignar, a company that Sean McCreanor, our guest today, built out of a necessity. After looking at his construction business, Sean realized that there wasn't a singular mobile-first platform that would cover all aspects of their operations, from scheduling and assignments to equipment tracking, safety, compliance, and more. Sean wanted all of this under one roof with real-time visibility into how his business was operating day-to-day. So what does an enterprising entrepreneurial spirit do? Well, they fill the gap. And that is exactly what Sean and his team at Assignar have done. How did you get going down the tech route? I mean, you know, I've read a little bit of your backstory, but maybe fill our listeners in, viewers in, to a little bit about how you got started.
Yeah, so I'm a tech guy. That's how I started my career. I'm 43 years old. My first job was just before the .com. Boom back in the day. It was highly technical. Used to do cybersecurity before they even called it that. As a little bit of context. We used to do it, myself and three colleagues at our first company that I worked for. We ended up starting our own business, and we were able to get an exit a few years after that, which was kind of nice and opportunistic and everything else. And at the time, I wasn't quite sure what I wanted to do, continue on, stay in tech, or, you know, what the kind of the next move was. And I had an opportunity to do something different and get into construction. And so I kind of done the opposite of what a lot of people do. They start in construction and then go into tech. I went the other way. And it was kind of nice, you know, because at the time in Australia, I'm originally from Sydney, Australia, there was a huge infrastructure bill that had been passed, not dissimilar to what's happening in the US right now. And so there was huge opportunity, and we thought, if we start this contracting business and we're really, you know, a good contemporary provider, we should be successful. And so the plan was, I would be the business guy. My partner down there would be the boots in the dirt. He's a construction background, construction professional. And that's what we did. We started the company and kind of grew it out. A couple of years later, by 2011, 2012, we started to notice that, like, our workers, you know, we had about 100, 120 workers and crews out in the field at the time. They started to, you know, send us information from the field via their smartphones, which was like kind of wild and crazy at the time. And so I looked around at our business and realized that we hadn't put any tech in our company, which is hugely embarrassing for me, being an old school tech guy. And so we had spreadsheets and whiteboards and manual process. Of course, we had an accounting system. We had an estimating tool. And, you know, we were trying to wrestle with, like, how do we systemize the way we operate? How do we make it easier to empower our crews out in the field and get the information we need from them and leverage technology? So we went out, I ran a search and looked for some technology that would complement our kind of project costing and our accounting and financials systems. And I found really old tech. You know, I found a couple of things, actually. I found really old tech that wasn't in the cloud. There was no mobility. Remember, this is 2012, 2013. You know, it's very early on in the construction tech kind of journey. I found point solutions. I found apps that would do one or two things, like they would do time cards or they would do safety or quality forms, those sorts of things. But, you know, being a contractor, I learned that, getting paid is really critical and very somewhat difficult, you know, when you're working for general contractors. They do play the cash flow game sometimes. And so having a platform with a single system of record for everything that happens on the project was really important. And so, yeah, I went out and I tried to find a solution, couldn't find one. And necessity is the mother of invention, they say. So I said to my business partner, Mick, who still runs our construction business to this day, I'll build us a prototype and we'll see what we can do and hopefully help other contractors. And that was kind of the genesis. We, you know, I came out of the day-to-day of my construction business in June of 2014. I found Marco, my CTO and co-founder, and we basically went into a product mode, you know, where Marco, myself, and a handful of engineers that we had join us really tried to build the product out for about a year and a half, because we found, you know, there were a lot of use cases that contractors needed solved in their business. And we thought, we have to, if we truly want to be a platform, we have to have a product that's deep enough to go to market. And so, you know, that was kind of the journey we started on. By the end of 15, I think it was, maybe early 16, we felt like we were ready to go sell it. So I hired two sales reps, first customer success manager, and then tried to figure out how the hell to sell software to contractors. So that's a little bit of the history and about us.
Immensely detailed. I like it.
One thing you said when you were starting your construction company, you made the comment you wanted to be a contemporary company. You know what?
Yeah.
Why was that, and what did that mean to you at the time? Why was that an important factor?
Yeah, construction's heavily fragmented, as we all know. There's a lot of really successful businesses that are, you know, sort of in the small to medium bucket that have been around for a long period of time. A lot of the times, and so for us, I thought, there's an opportunity for us not only to get some market share, but also introduce a better way of operating on projects. So, for example, on state or federally funded projects, safety and compliance are a really big deal, as is environmental reporting. And so we thought, if we lead from the front with some of those things, if we show them that, you know, we're a much more efficient operation, we're a safer operation, and this is where technology can help, that should translate into us building a great reputation and ultimately winning more business. And then that was kind of the mindset we went in to starting that company with. You know, it's not just about having the cleanest truck or the newest excavator on the job site. It extends far more than that. And, you know, the kind of the wake up for me was, in a lot of those contracts, you're mandated as the subcontractor. You have a contractual obligation to report how much diesel fuel we consumed on the job site, or how many toolbox talks we did, and did we take any actions, you know, if we found incidents or safety risk on the job site. And right. So the large owners, the state and federal governments, put a tremendous amount of value on those things, equally as much as quality of the product or the project that you deliver. And that's worked really well for us. And I think, you know, we're really proud of our safety record that we've been able to maintain. We went through a number of the ISO certifications. We did quality, safety, and environmental across the board. And again, trying to demonstrate to our customer that we have a very systemized way that we run the business. And ultimately, we're a safe pair of hands. Because I can't count how many times I would hear from my customer that, you know, they just couldn't get a hold of Jerry from another contractor. And Jerry was the only guy that, like, knew what was going on, and the coordination would fall down. And of course, that impacts every other trade on the job. And so, you know, it kind of that kind of mindset really, really helped us.
So I wanted to spend a few minutes on this break just talking about why we haven't had an episode for very long. And, you know, Builtcast is not my day-to-day job. It's something fun that Kurt and I do on the side. And we like to bring guests on that are going to add value to our listeners. And you're going to take away something that you can utilize in your business or just, you know, be inspired to, you know, utilize in your company. And You know, through COVID really until now, I've been in the trenches. I've been putting in place digital first initiatives and, you know, really focusing in the operations of Bangert Inc. And that's ultimately what I'm accountable for at the end of the day. And, you know, through this whole transition and COVID and all of this stuff really now and really through to the end of the year and probably into some of next year, you know, we've been transitioning to a 100% remote company with a virtual headquarters. You know, for 38 years, we've had offices either in Ohio or Missouri or Iowa or Minnesota or Kansas, you name it. And this is the first time that we've never had an office and all of our staff is working from home. And it's been a lot of challenges. We've done a lot of great things. I actually just wrote a blog post on our quarterly all hands where we all get together now in a singular location and work on the business instead of in it. And there's been a lot of great progress, but you know, it's been tough to allocate time to find the right guest and vet the right guest and get the right people on the show to add value to you, our listeners. So I just wanted to take a minute to explain that. I thought it was worth, you know, spending a few minutes on, and I hope that you'll stay with us. I can't promise that we'll get back into a regular cadence before the end of the year, but certainly in 2022, I hope to bring the show back to its fullest potential because I know that we have so many people out there who can influence and who can inspire folks to try new things and to embark on their own digital transformation. You know, there's a real value in data, right? I mean, that's to me, it sounds like that's the reason you created the product is that, you know, hey, this data is not only going to help my employees do their job better, it's going to help me run my business better, right?
Yeah.
And if it's siloed across so many different areas and applications and somebody's got to build Excel reports to combine all of that stuff together, it gets a little bit messy.
And then you have, you know, we hear this all the time, and I experienced it definitely in my business. You know, we have 10 or 12 legal entities in our group, right? And to get a consolidated view of what was going on and are we making money, I was looking in the rearview mirror 30 days. I could never get real-time visibility on are we winning or losing on projects? What's our utilization look like? What's our forward plan look like? Do we need to go and start recruiting or training new team members so that we can, you know, deliver on the projects that we've won, those sort of things? And I think for the most part, that problem still exists in a lot of contractors. But, you know, our view is we want to, you know, deliver real-time visibility into production rates, utilization, all of those key metrics that as a contractor you would love to know in real time. I used to love, you know, I'd go out and buy heavy equipment. You know, it's a lot of fun. You know, big boys toys and all of that. You know,
there's some pretty cool YouTube videos out there, I'll say, you know.
There really is. But like, how do you make a buying decision if you're going to go spend $500,000 on a new excavator or dozer or whatever? How do you make those decisions in real time? You know, we were always looking in the rearview mirror, and I think there's opportunity, to your point, with the data that our customers can surface and get insights from. Now they can make really, really smart decisions. And ultimately, those are the sorts of things that do impact bottom line. You know, unfortunately, you know, contracting can be a pretty low margin business. And so anything that you can do to incrementally move the needle, you know, kind of helps. And so I would never describe us as a data company to, you know, our customers for the most part, but it's ultimately that's what they get. They get an amazingly rich set of data, and you know, we have a full business intelligence module in our product that lets them, you know, unearth and get real-time insights into what's going on.
So what type of trades are you finding the Assignar product delivering the most value?
We're largely focused on, I guess, horizontal projects, infrastructure, heavy civil utilities, planes, trains, automobiles, that type of thing. Yeah. We have customers that do commercial. We don't really do residential. I think that's a different set of problems. But where they've typically got, you know, a fleet of something, assets, it could be F-150s, it could be dozers and loaders and excavators or something else. And there's just general complexity in the logistics of all of the projects they work on. We've got multiple projects, multiple crews, equipment, safety, quality, and production data, and just getting a kind of a view on that. And then in terms of, you know, geographies, I mean, you know, the US is our sole focus right now. We continue to have success in Australia and New Zealand, but, you know, the US market is really, you know, the market where we're going aggressively after. And, you know, we've built out a team. We've got about 50, 55, maybe 60 in the team now, sort of spread out everywhere from Colorado and then east and west. And, you know, we're really going after this market.
So construction or technology? Which one? What's the better business?
Oh, man. You know, it's funny. I love being back in technology. I absolutely love construction. I just think there's something about, you know, the built world and being a part of that. You know, when I was in my contracting business, I learned how to run projects. I learned how to operate all of our equipment. Not very well, but I did go and you know, operate some excavators and drive our cranes, and I got certifications and training and all of that. It's a lot of fun, and I think I have a tremendous amount of respect for the folks that are in construction and their families. You know, they give up a lot. They work crazy amounts of time. They give up weekends, nights, a lot of, you know, milestones along the way. I think that's why, you know, I love being back in tech, because we're trying to help them get better. You know, we're trying to help them not give up so much personally. You know, maybe like a little story there. We had a customer in Sydney in Australia, and they were about 100 person operation, big earthworks contractor, big civil contractor. And the two planners and schedulers, when I went out to visit them, they'd gone live about 3 months earlier. They came out, these two big burly construction guys, you know, that do all the planning, and they literally like ran over and hugged me. And they said, "Sean, because of your platform, we don't plan on Saturday and Sunday for the week ahead. We're done by 3 o'clock on Friday afternoon, and we're drinking beer at the bar with our buddies." And, you know, that's not me. That's not our platform. You know, that's our CS team, actually, and make the product as well. But those little stories, they're hugely impactful, right? I mean, these guys literally were working every weekend, and we gave it back. And, you know, going back to the build more thing, if we have a superintendent that can put time cards in 30 seconds for his entire crew, like, he's not sitting in the truck filling out paperwork at the end of the day when he could be on the way home. You know, we want him to get home when the dinner's still hot. It's not, you know, 10 o'clock at night and he's catching up on paperwork. And so that's kind of how we think about the product and the platform and the experience we want to deliver for customers. And so, yeah, back to your tech versus construction. I'm hugely mission driven. I'm glad to be in tech, and I think you know, I want to continue to, you know, help our contractors and customers, because I you know, I am one as well. So yeah.
What do you see some of the, I guess, what are some of the things that you see coming down the pipe in 5 years? I mean, what is construction, what does technology and construction look like then versus now?
Yeah, I mean, I think you know, the days of debating whether people, contractors are adopting technology is over. They're adopting technology, and they're looking at it through the lens of how can it help my business. So I think there'll continue to be more of that. I think there's phenomenal opportunity with the data that's coming from projects to not only gain insights, but also for things like benchmarking, performance, you know, tying back the loop to estimating how good or how close were we. Now I've got data to, you know, what impacted the project? Why did we win or lose? Was it weather? Was it logistics? Was there holdups and delays? Did the designs change? I think anecdotally, contractors can tell you some of those things that may have influenced a project. Well, now we've got data. So that's what I'm most excited by, is just the level of data that's coming from the field. And I think we're really in the early innings there in terms of, one, collecting it, but two, being able to do, you know, really impactful, insightful things with it. I think there's just all around, you know, construction tech is a really sexy space to a lot of investors and venture capitalists right now. You know, the market's huge. It's a, you know, 13% of global GDP, right? I mean, it's a massive opportunity. And for a lot of industry, it hasn't had a lot of transformation over the years. So I'm excited to just be a part of the journey for the foreseeable future, for sure.
That was Sean McCreanor, co-founder and CEO of Assignar. Since we have now officially released our partnership with Assignar, please make sure to join us for one of our launch series webinars. We'd love to see you there. You can choose a date that works best for you and find out more information about Assignar at our brand new page at bangertinc.com/assignar. That's bangertinc.com/assignar. Thanks for joining us. And if you like this episode, don't be shy. Share it with your friends and connections on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, and more. Builtcast is a production of Bangert Inc. Our producer is Kylie Jax. Our publisher is Luke Englert. Your hosts are Kurt and Reed Bangert. And our editor is Brandon Roten. For more info on Builtcast, head over to builtcast.com and our YouTube page at youtube.com/bangertinc. And don't forget, make it a great one.